Good morning and praise the Lord. I'm so happy that we are able to meet again as a church family. Even if we're not in the house of God, we're still the family of God. So I greet you. I'm thankful for your viewing this morning. You know, in Psalms 103, verse 1, it reads, "Praise the Lord, my soul, all my innermost being. Praise his holy name." And so when you consider this week you just had, you may have had some disappointments, you may have had some things that didn't turn out the way you wanted them to, this is still an opportunity for us to praise the Lord for what he has done in your life and what he is doing on an ongoing basis. We always want to remember Jesus, and whatever we do, whatever our situations, praise the Lord and watch how that changes your whole attitude about the things you're going through. And so we're going to come together to worship, to praise him, to glorify him, and just remember the things that God has done for us on an ongoing, continual basis. Let's pray. Gracious Lord, we're so thankful, Lord, for how you've saved us, Lord. We're thankful for the way you keep us, dear God. We are thankful for your provisions on a daily basis. And dear God, we come before you this morning offering up ourselves, dear God, that you would empty ourselves, Lord, that we may hear from you, Lord, that we may receive from your table, Lord, the bread, which is the word of God. We pray, Heavenly Father, Lord, that you would touch each person who's ministering this morning, the music ministry, Lord, AV, everyone who is serving, dear God, touch them, anoint them, sanctify them, that they would be filled with your spirit, and the things that we do and say during this service will be in line with your will, dear God. We pray for those who may be sick. We pray for those who may be ill at this time, Lord, that you would heal their bodies. But most importantly, Lord, we pray for those who may be ill and sick in spirit, dear God. Renew their spirit, Lord. Renew their soul. Encourage them in the word of God, dear God. Take all these things into your hands, dear Lord, that we may be ministered to you by you. And we'll be quick to praise you, to glorify you, to magnify you, for you are King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And it's in the mighty name of Jesus Christ that we pray with thanksgiving. Amen. Well, praise the Lord. Like I said, it's so great to see you, figuratively. I'm so happy that you're here with us this morning. And at this time, we're going to be ministered in song from our own Eric Charles.
Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. All right. Everybody at home, help me sing this. Come on. Victory is mine. Victory is mine. Victory today is mine. I told Satan, get thee behind. Victory today is mine. Oh, I got it. I thank God I got it. I got it. I thank God I got it. I got it. I thank God I got it. I got it. I thank God. Come on, let's say peace. Peace is mine. Peace is mine. Peace today is mine. Oh, I told Satan, get thee behind. Peace today is mine. Oh, I got it. I thank God I got it. Come on, help me sing. I got it. I thank God I got it. I got it. I thank God I got it. I got it. I thank God. Joy is mine. Joy is mine. Joy is mine. Joy today is mine. I told Satan, get thee behind. Joy today is mine. Oh, I got it. I thank God I got it. Come on. I got it. I thank God I got it. Come on, at home, wherever you are. I got it. I thank God I got it. I got it. I thank God. Oh, said victory. I said victory. Come on, wherever you are. I said victory. 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 Come on, help me say this part. I got the victory. I got the victory. You've got the victory. You've got the victory. I said victory. I said victory. I said victory. I said victory. I told Satan, get thee behind. I told Satan, get thee behind. I told Satan, you don't have no power. I told Satan, you don't have no dominion. I told Satan, you got to get out of my house. I told Satan, you got to get out of my job. I told Satan, you got to tell Satan. You got to tell Satan. You got to tell Satan. He don't have no power. He don't have no dominion. I told Satan. I told Satan. I told Satan, get thee behind. Victory today is mine. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. How many of you really believe that this morning, that victory is ours? You know, if you read the paper, if you spend any time on Facebook, you're going to think the devil has won. But I'm here to tell you this morning, victory is ours. It doesn't matter what your bills look like. It doesn't matter what's inside your refrigerator. The blessing is that when we leave this life, the Bible says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. What can Satan do to us? Romans 8:23. Can poverty or nakedness or anything, nothing stops the love of Jesus. And wherever you are this morning, you ought to be glorifying him. You need to be lifting him up for what God has done for you. I don't know what he's done for you. I know he keeps me. I know he satisfies me. I know he wraps me in his arms so that I can feel joy. I don't wait on the world to give me joy. I don't wait on the world to give me peace. All that comes from Jesus Christ. And I definitely don't wait for Sunday morning to praise the Lord, to worship the Lord, to glorify the Lord. Hallelujah, Lord God. What a mighty God we have. Victory is ours. Joy is ours. Peace is ours. Oh, you ought to worship him this morning. You better know who's the King of Kings this morning. It's not who's in the White House. It's not who sits on Parliament. It's God Almighty. Hallelujah, Lord God. Bless your name. Bless your name. Bless your name. You know, we may wear a mask when we go out. We may try to social distance, but it's not those things that are keeping you. Don't stop doing that, but it's God Almighty who keeps you. It's God Almighty who will satisfy you. It is God Almighty who's the lifter of your head. Oh, we ought to worship him this morning. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. What a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. If I can remind just one person as you go through this life, what a mighty God we serve. He hasn't left you. He hasn't forsaken you. He's God and he's the lover of our soul. Amen. Amen, amen, amen. If you will, I ask that you would join me in our scripture reading this morning. And our scripture reading comes to us from 1 Corinthians chapter 11. And we will be reading together. I was about to say responsively, but we're not. We're going to be reading together verses 17 through 34, starting at verse 17. In the following directives, I have no praise for you, for your meetings do no more harm than good. In the first place, I hear that when you come together as a church, there are divisions among you, and to some extent, I believe it. No doubt there have been differences among you to show which of you have God's approval. When you come together, it is not the Lord's Supper you eat. For as you eat, each of you goes ahead without waiting for anybody else. One remains hungry, and another gets drunk. Don't you have homes to eat and drink in? Or do you despise the church of God and humiliate those who have nothing? What shall I say to you? Shall I praise you for this? Certainly not. For I have received from the Lord what I also pass on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. Therefore, whoever eats this bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of Jesus, of the Lord. A man ought to examine himself before he eats the bread and drinks the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without recognizing the body of the Lord eats and drinks damnation on himself. That is why many of you are weak and sick, and a number of you have fallen asleep. But if we judged ourselves, we would not come under judgment. When we are judged by the Lord, we are being disciplined so that we will not be condemned with the world. So then, my brothers, when you come together to eat, wait for each other. If anyone is hungry, he should eat at home, so that when you meet together, it may not result in judgment. And when I come, I will give further instructions." May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of his word and sanctify it into our hearing. I was about to say, you may be seated at this time, but I'm sure you're probably already seated. I would like to extend a welcome to all of our online guests. If we were together in the sanctuary, all of our members would be applauding you and showing you some love. Therefore, please accept this welcome as an extension of love from the members of Christian Stronghold Church, and we pray that you will join us again. Welcome to our service, and we know you will be blessed. Next Wednesday at 8 a.m., next Wednesday on July the 8th, and next Sunday on July the 12th, we will continue our live streaming. Please be sure to stay informed of our COVID-19 shutdown update that you receive each week. Remember, the building is closed, but the Church of God is never closed. It is always open. On July the 8th, our Bible study lesson is Lesson 5, The Risk of Relationship, which is from Ruth chapter 3, verses 7 through 4, and verse 10. Deaconess Evelyn Moncrief went home to be with the Lord. She was the mother of Beverly and Bonnie Moncrief. On July the 11th is the virtual men's breakfast, live streamed at 8:15 a.m. Charles Neal is the speaker. See the flyer that was sent out in last week's update. On July 19th, is our virtual in honor of women's service during the 8:30 a.m. live stream. We have a birth announcement. On June the 27th, Michael and Leah Jones had a baby girl. Let's give them a hand, praise the Lord. Her name is Eden Joyce Jones. She weighed 6 pounds, 14 ounces, and was 19 and a half inches long. I also want to give you an update. I also want to congratulate all our graduates who graduated from college or from high school. We had such a great time last Sunday honoring our high school graduates. But I want to send a shout out to our college graduates as well. We praise the Lord that you were able to accomplish what the Lord put you on the path to do. And for our high school graduates, we praise the Lord. We're going to be praying for you in the days to come. Now, as we prepare for our offering, although you are with us by way of online streaming, we still need your financial support. Whatever platform you are using to watch this service, please follow the instructions on how you may give to support our ministry. If you're registered on the church's website, you can give by way of the members giving portal or from your mobile device by using the Church Life app. If you are giving online and no longer wish to receive the pre-printed offering envelopes in the mail, please email Kathy Osby at kosby@christianstronghold.com to opt out of receiving them. If you mail or bring in your offering, please continue to do so. The administrative offices is open Monday through Friday from 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. Feel free to come by and drop off your offering. And yes, please have on your face mask. Please do not come by for a social visit as we are practicing safety. As you do your online giving, let me encourage those of you who have been faithful in giving. We are blessed that you have continued your commitment to the Lord by giving your tithes and offerings. For those of you who are not giving, please let me encourage you to do so. You will begin to receive countless blessings, and you are missing out on those blessings by not giving. And if you believe that you do not have enough to give, be encouraged to know that you can start wherever you are. Give a little and watch how God will work in your life. Now, I ask that you would turn with me in your Bibles to 1 Corinthians chapter 16. First Corinthians chapter 16 at verse 1. Now, about the collection for the Lord's people, do what I told the Galatian church to do. On the first day of every week, each one of you should set aside a sum of money in keeping with your income, saving it up so that when I come, no collection will have to be made. So, as you think about that verse, give back a little, just a portion of what God has given to you. Let's pray. Gracious Lord, we're so thankful for those who gave, dear Lord, and for those who had the heart to give, but were not able to do so. Bless this offering, dear God. I ask, Lord, that you would give our leaders wisdom, those who will be handling the finances, Lord. Give them wisdom and guide them in the use of what has been given unto their hands for the service of your kingdom, dear God. We pray that you would bless this blessing in those who gave and all those who would want to. Bless them, Lord. Touch them in a mighty, mighty way. And we're going to praise you and thank you for all that you're doing, even right now in advance. And it's in the mighty name of Jesus Christ that we pray with thanksgiving. Amen. And now we'll be ministered again in song from Brother Eric Charles.
Hallelujah. For your goodness and mercy. Thank you, Lord, for your goodness and mercy. We are not worthy of it, but God, we're thankful for it. Hallelujah. For your goodness and mercy. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. We offer praise. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Oh, Lord, we give you praise and thank you, Jesus. Oh Lord, we bless your name, and we lift our voices to say thank you for your goodness and your mercy toward us. For your goodness and your mercy toward us, we offer praise. We offer praise. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Oh Lord, we give you praise and oh Lord, we bless your name and we lift our voices to say thank you for your goodness. Thank you, Jesus. And your mercy toward us. For your goodness. Hallelujah. And your mercy toward us. Your mercy toward us, for your goodness and your mercy toward us, we offer. And your mercy toward us, yes. For your goodness, we don't deserve it. And your mercy toward us, we offer praise. We offer praise, hallelujah. 'Cause you are worthy of glory, all of it, Lord. And hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. You're worthy of all praise for your goodness. Thank you, Jesus. And your mercy, come on, toward us. Thank you, Jesus, for your goodness. Thank you, Jesus, and your mercy toward us. Thank you, Lord, for your goodness, your mercy, Lord, your favor, Lord, your grace. Thank you for healing power, Lord. Your mercy, your unmerited favor, your grace, Lord. Thank you for sending your son to die for our sins, Lord. Lord, we thank you, Lord, for your goodness. Lord, Lord, your kindness, Lord, your favor, for your goodness, your goodness. Come on, thank you for his goodness, your goodness, for your mercy. We don't deserve your mercy. We haven't earned your mercy, Lord. For your goodness, hallelujah, and your mercy toward us, we offer praise. Lord, you're worthy. Lord, you're still in control. Lord, you're still mighty. We offer praise. God, we thank you, Lord, for all that you're doing, God. Hallelujah. We offer praise. Lord, we thank you, Lord. You're still in control, Lord. You're still on the throne, Lord. We offer praise. We know you're going to work it out. We know you're going to fix it, Lord. Hallelujah. We offer. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, God. Thank you, Lord.
Bless the name of the Lord this morning. Praise his holy name. I have the opportunity this morning to greet our senior pastor, Reverend Dr. Willie Richardson, my pastor for over 30 years. Pastor Richardson, the founder of Christian Research and Development. He's an author. Because of his teaching that I still have a marriage today, he blesses his congregation. He blesses other pastors with his class, Pastoring with a Purpose, and the purpose of a pastor's wife. Pastor Richardson has been on the battlefield serving faithfully for over 54 years. We are thankful to have him as a pastor. We're thankful for how he has been faithful to the Lord, even to serve us. So I'm going to get out of the way so that we may hear from our own senior pastor, Reverend Dr. Willie Richardson.
Good morning. I'd like for you to turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 26. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you will proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your word, the Bible. And Lord, we pray as we look into your word today that you might speak to each one of us, Lord, where we are. Lord, that you might speak and give each one of us personal message. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Today, we commemorate a Christian institution that is 2,000 years old. In our observance of the Lord's Supper, or communion. We participate in a form of worship that is as old as Christianity itself. The Lord's Supper, or communion, was inaugurated by Jesus himself on the eve of his crucifixion. Matthew 26:26 says, while they were eating, Jesus took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take, eat, this is my body. The Lord's Supper is what we call is a ordinance. The word ordinance means a prescribed practice or religious rite. Jesus only gave two ordinances or religious rites, which we are to practice. One is the Lord's Supper, and the other is baptism. Only saved people are to participate in the communion. Believers are warned of the consequences of partaking in the Lord's Supper in an unworthy manner. Everyone present is urged to practice self-examination, and then they can participate if they wish. Only those who are in close communion with the Lord are encouraged to participate. What is the communion service? Well, first of all, it is a symbolic service. Luke 22:19, and he took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Jesus Christ is speaking. And then Paul confirms this and backs it up in 1 Corinthians 11:25. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." According to these two passages, the Lord's Supper is a time of remembrance. It is a memorial worship service. The Lord's service is a symbolic reminder of what Jesus did for all people at the cross and the tomb. We are to remember an agonizing Lord. 1 Corinthians 11:24-25. "And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." The bread and the juice represents the broken body and the shed blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. As we participate in this observance, we need to remember the awful price that Jesus paid to save our souls. Please remember that when he died on the cross, he was dying in our place, and that he suffered greatly when he did. Isaiah 52:14 says, "Just as there were many who were appalled at him, his appearance was so disfigured beyond that of any man, and his form marred beyond human likeness." In other words, on the day before Jesus was crucified, that night before, he was beaten viciously. He was brutalized so badly that his face looked like a boxer. His eyes were swollen. His face was swollen. He was bruised, cut, and therefore he was not recognizable. That is how bad he was treated because he took our place. Remember that. Is the crucifixion fresh in your mind? That is what we need to keep fresh in our mind, that we might be indebted to him, that it would motivate us to live for him. A family lived on a farm out alongside a dirt road. Only on rare occasions would a car pass by. But one day, as one young member of the family was crossing the road on his bicycle, a car came roaring down a nearby hill, struck the boy, and killed him. An older brother said, "Later, when my father picked up the mangled, twisted bike, I heard him cry out loud for the first time in my life. He carried it to the barn and placed it in a spot we seldom used. Father's terrible sorrow eased with the passing of time. But for many years, whenever he saw the bike, tears began to stream down his face." The older brother continued, "Since then, I have often prayed, 'Lord, keep the memory of your death as fresh as that to me. Every time I take communion, let my heart be stirred as though you died only yesterday. Never let the communion service become a religious thing I just do out of being religious, but always a tender and touching experience. We are to remember an achieving Lord.'" In 1 Corinthians 11, verse 26, "For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, remember that Jesus Christ died, but the 3 days later, he arose from the dead." He lives. He lives. He's alive today. In Revelation 1, verse 18, Jesus himself speaks, "I am the living one. I was dead, and behold, I am alive forever and ever. And I hold the keys of death and Hades or hell." We are to remember an appearing Lord. In 1 Corinthians 11, 26, we read, "For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." After Jesus rose from the dead, he ascended back to heaven and sat down at his Father's right hand to wait for the day when he will return to earth to receive his people unto himself. Every time we take the Lord's Supper, we are declaring to a lost world that we believe in a returning Christ, a returning Lord. It is a motivator to live a clean life because we are waiting daily for his return. It is a symbolic service. It is a symbolic service. And next, we also realize it is a sacred service. It is a sacred service. 1 Corinthians 11, 26. "For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." The Lord's Supper is a sacred for at least three reasons. The Lord's Supper is sacred for at least three reasons. It was instituted by Christ. Jesus created the first Lord's Supper before he went to the cross, and he intends for Christians to follow his example. It is sacred because Jesus set the example. It witnesses to Christ. When we participate in the communion, we declare our faith in the death, burial, resurrection, and the return of Jesus Christ. It still offers salvation. It still offers salvation. That is the third reason that it is sacred. Over 2,000 years ago, Jesus went to a cross and died for the sins of humanity. That he rose from the dead, and that he lives today and will return for his people. Salvation is offered to all sinners. Anyone who is not saved, anyone who does not know the Lord, anyone that has not been born again supernaturally through the Holy Spirit, the doors are open if you would only come to Christ and turn your life and your will over to him. It is symbolic service, and it is a sacred service. Next, it is a special service. In 1 Corinthians 11:18, we read, "In the first place, I hear that when you come together as a church, there are divisions among you, and to some extent, I believe it," Paul says. And then in 1 Corinthians 11:28, 34, he goes on and says, "A man ought to examine himself before he eats of the bread and drinks of the cup." Read this. I remember when I was a boy in church, and there would be times that when came time for the communion, there would be some people that would pass the bread and the juice past them, and they wouldn't take communion. And it confused me until I went to Bible college and learned about what the communion means. The reason those people didn't take communion, now this is amazing, I feel they were much better Christians than we are today. They would examine themselves during the service and felt that they wasn't worthy to take the communion because they had some sin in their life. Now, that meant that when they didn't take communion, that meant that everybody else knew that saw them pass the plate. Yet today, people don't do that. I stand and I watch people. Everybody takes the communion. You mean to tell me all these folk living such good lives at Christian Stronghold? That everybody's in right standing with the Lord? No, people are not as honest as they used to be. But anyway, 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 28 again, "And a man ought to examine himself before he eats of the bread and drinks of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without recognizing the body of the Lord eats and drinks judgment on himself." Now, please pay attention to what we're reading. If you do have sin in your life and you take the communion, that you are actually bringing God's punishment on yourself right here, right now, as you go through a worship service where the communion is being given. 30, that is why many of you, look at what it says, that's why many of you are weak and sick, and a number of you have fallen asleep. Because of taking communion and being unworthy, God's punishment was weakness in the person's life. In other words, they could not be happy and they could not have peace. Then some people, they were actually sick. God made them sick. They became ill because they took of the communion and they had not repented and they had not gotten themselves straight before they got to communion. And it says some have fallen asleep, meaning God kills some people. God takes some people's lives because of what they do. Now, you might say, I'm guilty of that. He hasn't made me sick or took my life. It's called mercy. Mercy. God is a merciful God. But at some point, if you remember, and you probably don't if you got that kind of attitude, in the Bible, there are times God gets fed up and takes his mercy away, and he becomes angry because we think we are taking advantage of him because he's merciful. That is why many of you are weak and sick, and a number of you have fallen asleep. But if we judge ourselves, we will not come under judgment. When we judge by the Lord, we're being disciplined so that we will not be condemned with the world, meaning we will not go to hell with the lost people of the world. So then, my brothers, when you come together to eat, wait for each other. If anyone is hungry, he should eat at home so that when you meet together, it may not result in judgment. And when I come, I will give further directions. What is he talking about? Wait for one another. They not only had the communion, the drinking of the wine and the eating of the bread, but they had what they call a love of fellowship. And they actually served dinner in advance of the communion. It was a free meal. And a lot of folk, because it was free, that I've noticed at some of our funerals, after our funerals, when we eat food, there are people that actually taking food. And I tell you, one of the things that really have bothered me, I know some of y'all get mad at me, but I don't care, that some folk are bringing bags to take food home, and the food was not for them. The food was for the people that being mourning, and then it was also for the people who was waiting on those who were in mourning. And then, of course, there are other people that the food is supposed to go to, not folk to take the food home in bags. Now I said it. The Lord's Supper service offers the church an opportunity to come together. Anytime the saints, Christians can gather themselves together and focus on the Lord Jesus Christ is a special time. Before we receive the Lord's Supper, there are two things we must do: repent and renew our lives with Christ. We had the opportunity to repent before each and every communion service. Our sins, 1 Corinthians chapter 11, 27 through 30. Therefore, whoever eats the bread or drink the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and the blood of the Lord. A man ought to examine himself before he eats of the bread and the drinks of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without recognizing the body of the Lord eats and drinks judgment on himself. That is why many of you are weak and sick, and a number of you have fallen asleep. The Corinthians were guilty of taking the Lord's Supper service lightly, and as a result, some of them were sick, others had died. The Lord still judges us today. Before you take communion today, examine yourself, or when the next time we take communion, take the time to confess your sins to God and receive forgiveness. In 1 John chapter 1, verse 9, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. Our sinfulness is the other thing we should concern ourselves about. What are we talking about? We are not only to remember ourselves at communion, but to be concerned for other members who are struggling with sin and troubles. In other words, instead of talking about people in their failures, or talking about people that we know are in sin, we should go to them, give them a hand, and pray with them, walk with them, and help them to be able to get out of the sin. We need to care about the lost and the unsaved. In other words, every single opportunity we get, we should reach out and share with unsaved people how to become a Christian, how to receive Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. First of all, we should consider those in our own family and our own friends and loved ones. Then reach out to co-workers, neighbors, and strangers. We have the opportunity to be renewed. What do we mean by that? Communion is a time for us as Christians to look at our commitment and vision. Look at the future before us that we might live better lives. A time to remember why God wants us to live. In other words, the fact that we all are still living means that God wants us to continue in his service. But so many of us forget all about we're supposed to be serving the Lord. And of course, there are some of you that are looking at me on television now, and you don't even come to church when there's no pandemic. You don't even come to church, so you don't hear me at all. So since you at ease at home, and I'm grateful and I'm thankful that you are actually listening to me now. But that's not faithfulness to the Lord when he has given you your health and your strength and you don't have the sickness. It is a symbolic service. It is a sacred service. It is a special service. It is a symbolic service. For the Corinthian church, the Lord's Supper was a time of gluttony and selfishness. The solemn service should be up right now. Whoever is taking care, thank you. The Corinthian church, the Lord's Supper was a time of gluttony and selfishness. As I already stated, there were some that was coming to get free meal through the love dinner. They had lost the true meaning of the Lord's Supper and were taking the whole thing lightly. When communion is received with faith and gladness, Jesus is glorified. The saints will be edified. When communion is received by faith and gladness, Jesus is glorified. The saints will be edified. Sinners will be evangelized. And God the Father will be exalted. When we call to mind the price Jesus paid for us and the fact he lives for our justification, you know what that means? That we are all justified. That is what, listen careful, guarantees all believers that you're going to heaven. All believers go to heaven. That's why I can be assured that when somebody dies that's a Christian, I can preach their funeral and talk about them being in heaven and going to heaven. Now, of course, some of you who are loved ones, relatives, and live close lives with them will remember maybe even the day that they die, they sinned. They might have cussed somebody out or something. You know that. It don't make any difference. The fact of the matter, if they're believed, they weren't saved because they were not sinning. They were saved because of what Jesus did, not what they did. So that's the reason why they go to heaven anyway, because they truly were Christians. But there are nobody that's perfect. So therefore, it is a solemn service. It is a solemn service. It is symbolic service. It is a sacred service. It is a special service. It is a solemn service. And lastly, it is a serious service. It is a serious service. 1 Corinthians 11, 28 through 30. A man ought to examine himself before he eats of the bread and drinks of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without recognizing the body of the Lord eats and drinks judgment on himself. That is why many among you are weak and sick, and a number of you have fallen asleep. We are to examine ourselves before taking communion. It is not an option. It's a commandment. It is the Greek verb. The Greek verb used here is in the imperative mood, meaning it is a commandment from God before you take communion. That's the reason why true Christians and Christians who are mature and believing take communion seriously. Take communion seriously. And listen to this. And don't want to miss communion. Don't want to miss communion. Half living members of the church, they can make it or they don't make it. The only thing that amazed me about that is I myself personally believe that if you call yourself a Christian and it don't bother you not to take the communion, I don't believe you're a Christian. I don't believe your heart's been changed. I don't believe you've been born again. So that's the only thing that I'm amazed at, that there would be people that God has made it so easy for you to be able to go to heaven that you refuse to go all the way and do what you need to do by faith so that he can save you. You ought to be sure that you're saved before you take communion. Be sure that you are saved. This is a worship service, the communion for saved people only. If you are unsaved, you will neither understand nor appreciate what we are doing when we take the Lord's Supper. If you're saved, I want you to come forward when the invitation is given at the end of the service. Excuse me, if you're not saved, please come forward today that you will be saved, that you will be able at the next communion to be a part of it. Then, of course, even as believers, before we take the communion, if you, many times as I repeated today, if you don't understand, I'll say it one more time. You better be sure you're right with the Lord. What am I talking about? Examine yourself and confess unrepentant sin. He will forgive you. He will forgive you. And then, thirdly, be sure you take it with the right attitude. Make sure you take communion with the right attitude. Make sure you have repented of your sins and are totally committed to live for Christ, that you are totally committed afresh to live your life for Christ. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, O Lord, we come today, O Lord, because we believe. And Lord, we thank you for every opportunity we get that we can take communion. And Lord, I pray for those who did not understand how important communion is, that they will be committed to it now. They will be always for the rest of their life, be committed to doing right. And I pray, Lord, that those who knew better, that they repent today and get their lives right. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Pastor spoke about this morning about getting right with the Lord, or as we say, getting saved. And I want to give you an opportunity, if you are not in Christ at this time, I give you an opportunity to make that change in your life. It's nothing difficult. There's no task that you have to perform other than committing your heart to Jesus Christ. Salvation in the gospel is found in believing that Jesus Christ is Lord, accepting him into your life, and professing him as Lord. So if you would like to take advantage of that opportunity, I'm going to give that to you right now. I'm going to pray a prayer, and if the intention of your heart is to be saved, I ask that you repeat this prayer after me, and you will be saved. Dear Lord, I know I'm a sinner. I know I fall short of your glory. I can't get to heaven on my own, dear Lord. There's no work that I can do that will qualify me for salvation. So I ask Jesus Christ to come into my heart at this time and save me, change me, and make me the kind of person you would have me to be. Lord, I thank you for your salvation. I thank you for coming to my heart and saving me. This I believe by faith. Amen. If you've prayed that prayer, I want to pray a prayer for you. Dear Lord, this new saved person has been sealed by the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit now indwells them. Dear Lord, I pray that you make their salvation real in their heart, that they will understand what they did this day, dear God. Strengthen them, stand by them, build in them what they need to live this Christian life. And we also be so happy to give you the praise and honor that's due you and you alone. In Jesus' name we pray with thanksgiving. Amen. If you pray the prayer of salvation, please contact our pastor Larry James at 215-877-1530 at extension 2009. If you would like prayer, if you are in need of prayer, and you'd like someone to pray with you, please call 215-877-1530 at extension 1126. Please leave a message and someone will get back to you very shortly. At this time, we're going to celebrate our communion. I pray that you've gotten some bread or a cracker or something like that and something to drink, that we may break bread and drink the cup together. As Pastor spoke about in his sermon, on the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took bread and broke it. That represented his broken body. So let us take the bread, break, and eat together. And then the scriptures say, likewise, after supper, he took the cup of wine, which represented his shed blood for our sins. Let's drink together. Let's pray. Gracious Lord, we are thankful for your sacrifice on the cross. We are thankful, Lord, that you left your throne of glory, that you came down here to earth in the body of a man. You were all the way God and all the way human at the same time, so that you could take the penalty of death for us. So we thank you for that sacrifice, Lord. We thank you for our salvation. And so we praise you and we give you the glory, which is due you and you alone. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Thank you for worshiping with us this morning. We pray, Lord, that you will join us again next week. And when we are able to turn as a church, we pray that you will come and join us and the congregation here at the building. Thank you, we praise you, and hope you have a blessed week.